Welcome to the Museum of Aquarium and Pet History. It's April 2024, and this month we have Squirrels as Pets, a historical overview. And in this overview, we are going to cover how long have squirrels been kept as pets in captivity, the types of squirrels kept as pets historically, what some of the literature says about squirrels from over 100 years ago, famous people who had squirrels as pets, and the MOAPH squirrel cage collection. Okay, so buckle up, get something to drink, and here we go. All right, before we start, I have one thing to do. My trusty scale, little box, my hat. Okay, so I live in the country, and on my property are Monterey pine trees. Monterey pines can get up to 200 feet tall. Those of you that, of course, celebrate Christmas, remember pine cones. These are the pine cones that you usually have around Christmas time. Some people burn them in the fireplace or use them as decoration. This is the average pine cone that has already dropped its seeds, and it weighs like not even a little over a quarter of a pound. But on the top of the tree, anywhere from 50 to 200 feet up, is a raw pine cone like this. And this thing is like a missile. All these are incredibly sharp edges. It could pierce your skin. The thing's really heavy. This thing weighs about 2.5 pounds, but they get up to 10 pounds. And at the base, very small base, it's been chewed by a tree squirrel. So when I go to take the trash out from my house to the street, and I walk the trash can out there, these squirrels up there think they're funny, and they chew this little thing, and it comes down like a missile. So I decided, because in California they call these widowmakers for a good reason, I think I read in the literature that at least 20 people a year are killed by pine cones, so I have decided to counteract that measure by wearing a hard hat. So just so you know, squirrels can be devious, and in this case, I've caught them off guard. All right, so that's my public safety announcement about squirrels. Make sure if you have them on your property and you've got pine trees, wear a hat. So how long have squirrels been kept as pets? All right, we have paintings in galleries of aristocratic families, both their children and adults, that have pet squirrels in them. And they're either holding the pet squirrel or they have it on a table with a little gold-plated leash. So we know that since the 1700s, squirrels have been kept as pets, probably longer than that. We know that basically squirrels make great pets because they are energetic, funny, hyper. But I have to stop myself here because it's really controversial. I mean, they do make great pets. The book says they make great pets, but they require attention and they require a commitment. If you don't give them attention and you don't give them a commitment of at least an hour a day, it's not the pet for you. Now, the other issue is, are they legal where you live? I think in the United States, about 17 states have laws saying that you can keep pet squirrels, certain kinds. In the other states, it's illegal to have pet squirrels. In Europe, it's kind of the same way. Belgium is a very pet-friendly country, and I know that many of the provinces in Belgium that you can have a pet squirrel. England's a little convoluted. I mean, they have some interesting laws. You can circumvent some of those and possibly have a pet squirrel, possibly not. It just depends on how you interpret the law over there and if you have a good attorney. But other than that, squirrels have been around for a long, long time. So let's talk about the type of squirrels that have been kept as pets. First of all, you've got the gray squirrel. And when we talk about gray squirrels, there's a zillion different kinds of gray squirrels. There's also the ground squirrel that is gray, and there's a tree squirrel that's gray. In California, most of the ground squirrels are protected, where the tree squirrels are not. So the gray squirrel also has a melanistic or black colored one. I think I have one right here. And they also have a white colored one, and they also have a albino one. And these all are very endemic to very specific areas. Like, for instance, they They said that the black one actually is from Kansas at some point. There's like a colony of black ones in Kansas. They actually, one town celebrates the black squirrel in Kansas. The white one is supposedly from Tennessee. The albino one, I believe, is Louisiana. I'm not positive, but all from specific areas. And these are all gray squirrels, okay? Now, when you talk about a red squirrel, there is a gray squirrel in the United States. It's called a red squirrel, though, but it's a light red color, kind of a brown color with sort of a white underbelly. It's not to be confused with the red squirrel that comes from England. See, in England and throughout parts of Europe, there is a bright red squirrel that is adorable. He has little tufts on his ears, little ear tufts, and they're beautiful. They're now a threatened species, so you can't keep them at all, but they've been kept for pets for hundreds of years, specifically in Europe. At some point, they were imported in the United States as well, but they never became established here if they were let loose accidentally. Whereas the gray squirrel was sent to nobility in England, and the person that got the shipment of gray squirrels there, I can't remember, it was the Earl of something, he let them go on his property because he thought it would be cute, and they became established, and that was one of the biggest mistakes that someone in Parliament could have made over there, because it outcompeted the red squirrel and caused some problems with the red squirrel over in Europe. So that is two of the types of squirrels. When I talk about gray squirrels, there's a lot of different kinds, and there is a tree and the ground. And we talk about the red squirrel, I'm predominantly talking about the one that lives in England. Okay, then we have chipmunks. Chipmunks are, when I was in pet shops back in the late 60s and through the 70s, I remember chipmunks being sold, and I remember flying squirrels being sold. I don't remember squirrels at all being sold. So I think the squirrels were kind of phasing out at those time frames. But chipmunks were still popular, and flying squirrels were really popular. And they remained popular, I think, through the 80s and 90s. Chipmunks, there is a lot of different varieties of chipmunks. One of the books says that there's 60 different varieties. Another book says that there's 35 different varieties. So I don't know who to believe. They are completely odorless. They never enter water. They keep their fur clean by rolling in their sawdust. And don't keep birds with chipmunks, as they have been known to have a canary dinner. Okay, so that's probably good advice. The name chipmunk came from the chip sound, or it came from American Native Indian word of akachipman or chipman, which means head first, in reference to the way they descend tree trunks. Their favorite food is grapes and peanuts. And interesting side story, my wife and I used to love to go to the 17-mile drive in Pacific Grove, which takes you from Pacific Grove to Carmel, and it goes along the ocean, and there's the lonesome pine tree that's out there. It's a beautiful drive, and it's full of these ground squirrels. And we drove it one time, and I saw these kids out there sitting down feeding peanuts to the ground squirrels, and the squirrels were all over them. They were like on their lap, they were like climbing up them, you name it, and they were feeding them these peanuts, and it was adorable. So the next time we went, I decided I'd get a bag of peanuts, and I'd do the same thing. And so we're sitting out there, and we're feeding peanuts to these squirrels, and the squirrels would crack them open, and they'd stuff them in their cheeks, because squirrels go and they hide their food for wintertime. They eat some of it, but most of it they hide. So fast forward 20 years later, I go back to 17 Mile Drive, you know, bringing back these old flood of memories, thinking I'm going to go feed the squirrels again because it was so much fun. And there's women out there, these older women, that are the squirrel police. And they're basically saying you can't feed the squirrels anymore because they're getting too fat. So that was the end of our squirrel feeding adventure in California. And yes, squirrels can overeat and get fat in captivity. In the wild, I don't know. But that's too bad, because that was a lot of fun. So in any case, that is the chipmunk and my ground squirrel little adventure. Now the flying squirrel, that's a whole different animal. Whereas these other squirrels are diurnal, or they're around it during the daytime. The flying squirrel is a nocturnal squirrel. It's the only nocturnal one. Now there's different species of flying squirrel, but it is a nocturnal species, meaning it's, you know, awake around 5 o'clock at night. So I think that you have to realize that if anybody wants to have a flying squirrel as a pet, that you need to be a night owl or work from home and have a night job, because they're awake then, and if you're going to bond with them or imprint on them as a pet, you want to make sure that you give them that at least hour of time that they need. And squirrels adore you. I mean, if there is a video I watched on a red squirrel out of England, and the guy had it loose in his house, and the thing, he just had it loose, and the squirrel would like run up on him, and it'd give him little kisses, and it would like, sometimes it would give him a love bite on his arm, and he would give it food. The squirrel would bury food in his house plants. Interesting little fact about squirrels, they love to hide their food because they're saving it for wintertime, but they can't remember where they hid it. So squirrels are notorious for forgetting where they hid their food. So if you have them in a house, they will basically bury it somewhere, forget where they buried it, and they'll go dig up all the rest of your house plants. So take that into consideration. Now, another thing we want to talk about is, what does the literature say about squirrels? Let's go back to 1862. We had a book in the library here at the museum called Handbook About Our Domestic Pets. This was published by Castle, famous publisher in London and New York. They talk about that the squirrels can be purchased from a bird fancier for 5 shillings, which is about $20 in today's money. Well, actually, no, it's $20 in 1862 money. Today's money would be a lot more. They do talk that you can buy squirrels from Whitechapel hay markets from farmer boys. So in other words, a lot of farmer kids are finding abandoned nests of squirrels or whatnot, and they're taking them to the hay markets and they're selling them there. This is in 1862. They also had an interesting fact that squirrels can get a piece of tree bark, and they could float across streams and rivers, fanning the air with their tail to conduct the vessel to its desired haven. And I've read that in a couple books now, vintage books, that basically squirrels, if they have to cross water, and they don't like to forever, I mean, especially chipmunks don't ever want to touch water, but if they have to, they will basically, they'll basically try to get a little raft, piece of bark, and they will basically sail it right across a little river, a little body of water. I think that was really awesome, by the way. Okay, so let's circle back to chipmunks and what some of the books say. One of the books from 1959 talks about that chipmunks will sing to each other, which is kind of cool, sort of like mice. Mice will do the same thing. They talk about always getting an exercise wheel, and that's really controversial. I've seen a few books that say don't get an exercise wheel. The other thing, when we talk about flying squirrels are the one that's considered the easiest to tame. They don't actually fly, but they glide. They have a connective tissue between their front and hind leg, and when they're in a tree, they'll jump, and they'll open this up, and they'll glide down, and they'll take their tail, and they'll go like this to try to like make their distance or make their path go to where they want to go, to like a tree that's, you know, far away. So it's kind of neat. They can glide up to 150 feet, according to the literature, and they are, again, nocturnal. And they're one of the cutest little squirrels. They're one of the cutest and one of the easiest to tame. So let's now get into some famous people that have owned squirrels. Probably the most famous is Elizabeth Taylor, or the most famous actress, I should say. She had a pet chipmunk at age 14. And she wrote a journal about this pet chipmunk named Nibbles. The book's called Nibbles and Me. And she had it on the film set when she filmed National Velvet. And it was going to be in a Lassie movie called Courage of Lassie, but unfortunately that did not happen. But interesting book, and she had the pet chipmunk all the way to the end of its life, and it was by itself, which is interesting because most of the books tell you to if you're going to have a squirrel, you need to do two things. One of them has to have a large aviary or a very, very large cage with a sleeping box, lots of tree branches in there so they can climb around, and you should either have that and then interact with them, or let them loose in your house. And a lot of people let them loose in their house, or even let them loose out of their aviary, you know, leave the door open and stuff, and because they normally come back because they know where their food's at. And they also get attached to the person that owns the squirrel. So that's an interesting little thing. The problem with a squirrel bonding to you, though, is that if it does bond to you and it does get out, you have it and it doesn't come back, and they say if you have a pair, a lot of times the pair won't come back, but a single one will. But the pair won't come back, and then a lot of times they can get eaten by a owl at night or a hawk during the day, that kind of thing, because they're not prepared to live in the wild. They didn't get enough experience of wild living. So that's something to take in consideration if you ever have one as a pet. So Elizabeth Taylor had Nibbles and Me and I did a book on it. As far as presidents go, Warren Harding and Harry Truman had pet squirrels. And interestingly enough, they were both named Pete. So they both had Pete squirrels. Benjamin Franklin lived in London in the 1770s as a representative of Pennsylvania. He was a guest of Jonathan Shipley, a bishop in the Church of England, his wife Anna Maria, and their 6 children. Franklin asked his wife Deborah, back in America, to ship an eastern gray squirrel over to the Shipleys as a gift, who they proudly named Mungo. As soon as the squirrel got over there, the daughters fell in love with this little squirrel, but unfortunately, their dog Ranger killed it quite quickly, and then Franklin wrote an epitaph to it saying, "Few squirrels were better accomplished, for he had a good education, had traveled far and seen much of the world. Thou art fallen by the fangs of wanton, cruel Ranger." And that's what Franklin wrote about the squirrel Mungo. Teddy Roosevelt, who had more pets than any U.S. president, had a pet flying squirrel. And that's just some of the people that have had pet squirrels, some of the people in the past. Of course, this day and age, we have famous Instagram people with squirrels, YouTube people with squirrels. So there is a lot of squirrels out there. Now, let's talk about cages. If we started some of the earliest cages, they were probably more or less folk art in all different degrees of craftsmanship. Here's a very old folk art cage. There's 2 of them. This one here is metal with a crude wire little running wheel. And this is really a box or a sleeping box with a little running wheel. And you have to remember, and I've said this before about bird cages, that, you know, back in the 1700s or even early 1800s, there was no cell phones, TVs, there was nothing. So if a kid worked on the farm or if a kid worked in a factory, the first thing he wanted to do is take his pets out. So these pets would get a lot of interaction outside of the cage. They didn't live their entire life in the cage, all right? So these, again, are some of the more primitive cages that we have in the collection, and these are probably from the, I would guess, early 1800s. Okay, continuing with folk art cages. Now these are ones that are made by craftsmen. These aren't ones that probably went in production. These are probably one-offs. Maybe they made a couple, but these are definitely from the 1800s, European, probably French, or possibly Dutch. There is a little expressions on the top here, and I'm not sure. I looked at them, and I'm not sure if it's Dutch or French. I can't read either language, but they're just beautiful, the amount of craftsmen that went into these with the little wheel, the little wire wheel. This is a dual cage, which is really unusual. And I don't know why somebody put a bird on there, but somebody stuck a bird on the wheel. But this is a dual chipmunk cage. And again, chipmunk because it's a smaller size cage. It could be for red squirrels because it's Europe. So it's possible it's red squirrels or chipmunks. A lot of work went into this cage. And it's funny, when we bought this cage, it was sold as a dollhouse, which I thought was really interesting that somebody thought this was a dollhouse and not a animal cage because it's got these wire wheels. I'm like, no, I don't think you put a doll in there. But it's beautiful. It's got all kinds of little things going on, all kinds of cut out little wood here with different, this has got on the side. It's got chicken and a little birds and a little boy. You can see all that right there. It's just gorgeous. One of the rarest squirrels is the Prevost squirrel, which is one of the most beautiful squirrels that you could find. It's from the Asian Peninsula, Indonesia, all in that area. If you're from that area and you could legally own one as a pet, it'll set you back about $1,000. It's probably the most expensive squirrel that's sold, and it's also one of the most desirable, and it's one of the rarest. So it is beautiful, the Prevost squirrel. All right, so let's get into some other cages here. Okay, now when we get into production cages, we'll start with the pretty simple one right here. This is one of the older ones that we have. This is John Jewett and Sons. It's from the 1884 catalog that he has. And it's a typical squirrel cage with a big wheel here for like a gray squirrel, because John Jewett was out of New York, was where the company was. The top opens up, and so basically the squirrel has a little sleeping quarters up here. There's a little hole he can go into, and he sleeps up in the top part. So again, he's got the little place he can stay and run around before he's taken outside for a little relaxation or kept with the owners. He's got the wheel and he's got sleeping quarters. And then we have another one here from John Jewett. These are both around 1884 to 1889, right in that time zone. And you can see there's a different design that goes in the front here. Both of these old. The interesting thing about these cages is how much they cost. I mean, a cage like this in that time frame costs the equivalent of about $150 to $200, which was an enormous amount of money. So the only people that really can afford a cage like this would be people that were wealthy. This was a long time ago, and that's why you see a lot of folk art cages out there, because people couldn't afford to buy these cages, so they made the cage themselves. So that is John Jewett. This cage is from Oliver Lindman and Company out in New York. This particular one could be as late as 1917 to 1925. In that time period, they sold for between $127 and $248 in today's currency. But back then, you could buy them for $5.25 or $7.67. But I've seen these cages in today's currency go for as much as $500 to $600 in today's monetary value. So that's the interesting thing about the cages. They were very, very expensive back then. And it seems like Osborne and Lindman really had a huge selection of squirrel cages, as many as not, if not more than Hendrix. And Hendrix was a much larger company. And it's interesting that when Hendrix absorbed Lindman and Osborne, that pretty much Hendrix sort of phased out squirrels cages. I mean, they had a couple different models, but that was it. So the cages sort of gradually went away to just one cage. And it was very simplistic back in the 60s when they had probably the last squirrel cage that I saw. Other than that, I remember when flying squirrels were sold in the 60s and 70s, they were always sold with an aviary, a large aviary. They were never sold with a small cage. So this particular cage, which is interesting, is probably an import. You can see the flag here, the red, white, and blue flag, but it's not an American flag. I've seen this cage come up for sale quite a few times. I think it was imported. I'm not sure exactly when. It's possible this was imported as late as the 50s, but I'm not sure. It does have the slotted screws, which means it's an older cage, because they really didn't have Phillips head screws until like the 60s and 70s. So this is a interesting cage. It has a little chimney that comes off, and there's your door, sleeping quarters inside. There's a little shelf up here where the squirrel would sleep, and a large enough wheel that you could have two squirrels in here. Basically two could run at the same time. So that is an imported cage. So this cage right here came from the United States, but I believe it's European. You can see the wheels in the middle. And again, this is something that was crafted by someone, so one off, very folk artish. And probably, again, if I had to guess, I would say Brussels or somewhere in Belgium, because a lot of cages came from that neck of the woods. Also France. So that's the folk art one. Next door to it looks what looks like a Hendrix cage. And that's a simple Hendrix cage, but still very expensive. They made those from like about 1880 up until 1920s, right in that realm. And the next door to this one with the basket, that is a really primitive cage, production cage. Not sure who made that one, but look at the size of the inside wheel. It's huge. So that's definitely for a very large squirrel. And it does have, in fact, the little basket, which their nesting basket that they can actually put their babies in if they bred.
I would guess that that cage is 1850s or earlier, just by the way that they connect the wire and how primitive it is. It's an unsigned cage. It is metal, but we don't know much about it. We have not seen it in a catalog ever. Okay, on the left, you've got what is a typical Hendrix cage. Again, late to 1800s to about 1920s. It has a nest basket in it. It's all steel except for the brass connection rod that holds the wheel on. That's brass. Nice looking cage. Next to it looks like another Hendrix cage with the metal feeder inside of it. Seldom do we get one with a metal feeder. Little shelf for them. Both cages actually have a shelf for them to rest on. And again, a wheel. And then the far cage on the right is again a wood primitive cage, something that was made by someone. And that's all wooden wire. And again, that's probably 1850s or earlier. It's a very old cage.
So just to interject, some of these Hendrix cages we've shown have cost as much as $30 each, which in today's currency is $544. So again, definitely a cage for someone that was wealthy, had money. And that dollar amount is from the 1924 Hendrix catalog number 4, where the cage is priced at $30. And if you convert the currency, that's what you get, $544.
So this is the second largest cage in the collection. This is an Osborne cage, and it's a dual wheel. So it would be made for basically keeping a pair of squirrels. You know, people wanted to breed them. It's all metal. It's painted. It's the original paint. It's quite a phenomenal cage to find something that's lasted this long. I'm sure this was 1880s, and I'm sure the price it sold for is equivalent to $500 or $600 in today's currency. So it was not an inexpensive cage. It was for a pair of squirrels, people trying to breed them or keep them as a pair, but just a beautiful cage and has a little turret on the top. And at the very high roof, you could see the blue and orange original paint, which is quite interesting. So that is an Osborne dual wheel squirrel cage.
Okay, so this is a folk art cage that was made in Belgium and the French part. And it was sold to me by a dealer in France. Unfortunately, the roof cracked a little bit when it came in, but we could repair that. But it's a very large cage. It's got a very large wheel, so you could keep multiple squirrels in it, at least during the time period you could. But the amazing thing, besides the size of this cage and that it's a squirrel cage, which makes it very rare to begin with, is what happened on the right side, what this guy had done. Let me show you. So he made these little men, and when the wheel turns, this guy does his hatchet, this guy does his hammering, this guy is churning, it looks like. Not sure what they're doing. Some of them are broken, like this one right here is broken, we still need to fix it. But just to see all these little men that are working from the wheel turning, and the wheel's perfectly balanced. You'd think that a wheel this heavy, a squirrel couldn't turn, but it's completely balanced. I mean, it's just amazing the craftsmanship that went into this and the fact that this cage that's probably 1850s has survived 170 years. It's just amazing.
Okay, so that's all the squirrel cages that are in the collection for the Museum of Aquarium and Pet History. I hope you enjoyed it. And just to recap, if you want a pet squirrel and you're in California, they're only legal in 19 states, and they're illegal in 31 states. In fact, in California, where they're illegal, you cannot own one as a pet, but you can hunt one. Actually, you could trap, hunt, or kill squirrels in California if they pose a nuisance or crop pest or during hunting season. Ground squirrels are excluded from the law because they are not considered a non-game animal. Okay, so again, California, what can I say? I hope you enjoyed it. It was a lot of work putting this together. I thank Meredith, as usual, and Paul for helping me with all these things. And again, I thank you for being with us. I hope you have a wonderful week, and we'll see you next week with another 5-minute video. Again, take care. Bye.
A thunder of jets in an open sky, a streak of gray, and a cheerful... loop, a whirl, and a vertical climb, and once again, you'll know it's time for the adventures of Rocky and Bullwinkle and friends. Starring that supersonic speedster, Rocket J. Squirrel, with his pal, Bullwinkle the Moose.
This is the Alvin Show. The Alvin Show, you're positively gonna love the Alvin Show. There's Dave Seville, and one is more. Here's the boy who giggles, known as Theodore. Now you see, on camera three, the brother known as Simon on the family tree. And here's the star of the show.